Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I would like to show you the job pattern as the best way to handle asynchronous tasks, such as communicating over a socket. What we want to do here is this application where we can query for the person's name and we get results, and then it will query for the flags for the countries and then update the flags in the list. We have done that in the fourth video of the communication series with a single class called connection. And in that class, we would have a method, query person matches, which fires off the request over the socket. And when the results are available, they come back as signals, such as matches fetched, which give us a vector of persons. And then later on, it queries for the country flags and we get the signal country flag fetched. Now, the problem with this is we have a user that tells us, well, my server is a bit slow. And what happens is that I have time to make a second query before the results of the first one come in. And when that happens, I get an assert in the application because basically it's telling me I was dequeuing from the list of country names and it was empty and I get an assert. Now, if we have a look at the code, we can see here that when we process the matches for a person request, we will remember the list of the country names. But what if we do two queries in parallel or one just after the other? Then what happens is that we are overwriting the list of country names. So I added an assert here, and indeed, if we try to reproduce this bug, we'll see that we can hit this assert. A simple way to reproduce the bug, rather than, well, making the server slow, let's just hack a little bit into the code here where we say, once we're connected, we are simply going to fire off two requests right away. One request for Mike and one request for David. And if I run the application that way, it will hit the assert that I added in there. If I'm lucky enough to run the right one, there we go. And you can see here that it actually hits the assert. The list of country names was not empty because I was still doing the first request when the second request came in and they simply stepped onto each other's toes. The other problem with this approach of a single connection class is what if we have different parts of the code, like two different classes that want to fire off requests over this socket? And then when the signals are emitted, we don't know which class it's for. Let me show you that on a diagram. If we have like this, this is what we have here. With the connection class, when we emit matches fetched, all of the users of that connection class are going to be signaled. They will receive the signal and do some processing on it. But they don't care, right? If the widget is the class that fired off a request, then this other class doesn't want to see the results. And vice versa, if the other class is the one that did the request, then widget doesn't want the results. So what we want instead is to use the job pattern, which means we are going to create a job class, and any user like the widget or another class, any user that wants to actually fire off requests, they will create a job, and the connection will hold a list of jobs. So when the first response comes in over the socket, we know it's for the first job in the list, and that job will emit the signal matches fetched, meaning the widget can then get the results. And when the response comes for the second request, it will go to the second job, and that goes to the other class. So we want a job class, and we want a list of jobs in the connection class. How do we do that in code? Let me show you on this solution here. We created a job class, actually just a base job to start from. Actually, let me show you how it's used first. In the widget, when we press the button, we are going to go here and create a new job, right? A person match job. This is where we fire off the request. We connect to the signal so that we are notified when it's done, set up the query that we want, and then we call start on the job. What does start do? It will simply add the job to the list of jobs in the connection. And in add job, so we add it to the list, and we can right away send the request over the socket. So if we do multiple jobs, one after the other, What we do here is it's actually okay to send all of the commands on the sockets buffer, because it will just pile them up and send them whenever possible, and that's fine, right? We use the buffer of the socket to simplify them off right away. If we couldn't do that, we could simply wait until the first job is done before we send the command for the next one. It would amount to the same. Okay, now we have fired off the request and we have the replies that come in from the server. That's in slot ready read. And what we can do here is when we get the response, we know it's for the first job in the queue. So we simply dequeue a job and ask it to process the response. So instead of having many, many different types of tasks in the connection class, which would grow over time and become really big, we can simply cut that in pieces, make it modular, have every type of operation in a different job class. And if we have a look at the person match job class, we have how to do the query and how to process the response nicely encapsulating in that job class. So the benefits of this pattern are that we store the state for each query independently. If we needed to have more member variables to do things in multiple steps and so on, we could do all of that in the job class. If we have multiple users, they will each get their own response without any problem from that. Instead of having many parameters to a single function, as we had in the initial connection class here, we were lucky that it was just two parameters, but it could be 10, right? Instead of that, we have a nice class with setters, like in this job class here, we have set field, set search value. We could have many setters if needed. The code is more modular, as I mentioned. And also, we had a bit of a hack where we would repeat the request name in the response to know what kind of request it is. We don't need to do that anymore. We simply know it's for the first job. So this pattern is quite common. The job pattern is found in Qt itself. If you have a look at QNetwork reply, which is basically used for HTTP requests and responses, you create a network reply class, and that's what holds basically your task. It's the job, right? In KDE, we also have developed a job class called KJob, and it's used all over the place. If you copy a folder in Dolphin, this is going to create a job, and that's why you can have multiple copy operations in parallel, and they are all jobs, and that allows to have more things than here, like progress information, canceling, all of that. In the library I wrote for SOAP communication called KD SOAP, there are also jobs that are actually generated by the code generator, but that is a topic for another video, which I plan to do soon. So overall, the job pattern is useful for anything around a socket, like HTTP communication or your custom protocols, anything else. It can also be useful for tasks that are delegated to secondary threads, where you have a key object that emits a signal when it's done. And here again, you want to encapsulate that with a job class so that multiple users of that work being done in a secondary thread can simply get their own results and not everyone else's results. So I hope you found this video on the job pattern useful and that you will use it in your Qt programs whenever you want to have asynchronous operations. Stay tuned for more from me and see you soon. Bye-bye.